The best choice is D, thyroid gastro duct cyst. Let's look at some of the features make choice D the best answer here. You can see that there's a cystic lesion that's slightly off midline and looks benign, in that the wall is thin, the internal fluid content looks very homogeneous. There's no RAM enhancement and there's no suspicious internal enhancing soft tissue component. Now the location is also very typical for thyroid gastro duct cyst, in that majority of them, more than 50% of the time, is going to be, like this case, inferior to the hyoid. About 30% of the time, they can be right around the hyoid bone, and minority of them could be above the hyoid. And the location that they are typically midline, especially ones that see at the hyoid above the hyoid, they are midline. Inferiorly, they can be midline or slightly off midline, sometimes embedded within the strap muscle. And it should not be, though, more than 2 cm deviate off midline. So let's look briefly at the development of the thyroid gland, and that can help explain the thyroid gastro duct cyst formation and its location. So you start off at foramen cecum at the midline, at the tongue base. You have a small invagination that the thyroid diverticulum. You start off with a small rest of the endodermal tissue, and that will penetrate through the mesoderm, follow the course of the thyroid gastro duct. At midline through the tongue base, in front of the hyoid and loop around the hyoid bone, then descend at midline or slightly off midline anterior to the thyroid cartilage, proliferate into thyroid tissue at the first and second tracheal ring. And the thyroid gastro duct will involute. Sometimes you can have remnants of the thyroid gastro duct forming, in this case, the extra lobe, the parietal lobe. So you follow the entire course. If the thyroid gastro duct fail to envelope along its course, has a cystic dilatation, you have a formation of thyroid gastro duct cyst. So it could be anywhere along the course. In this case, as in this classic case, majority of them will be inferior to the hyoid bone, forming a large thyroid gastro duct cyst. Because of that development, sometimes you can see cases like this. 6-year-old child, you have a round hyperdense lesion at the tongue base at the level of foramen cecum. Now the patient incidentally has an ultrasound of the thyroid gland, shows lack of a proper development of the thyroid gland. And this lesion right here is before contrast. And remember, the thyroid gland is dense even before you give contrast. So the patient actually have a functional thyroid at its aberrant location. And in this case, at the foramen cecum, this is a lingual thyroid. So some stuff that they can ask you on board exam, including this is the most common congenital neck mass, usually midline, painless, and often discovered incidentally. Whenever you do suspect a thyroid gastro duct cyst, you want to make sure that the thyroid gland looks okay, so you can do that with ultrasound. Now, some of the complications including infection. So in that case, it can look like an abscess with RAM enhancement and surrounding soft tissue inflammation. You can have a trauma that causes internal hemorrhage, and rarely you can have malignant transformation, especially papillary thyroid cancer. So for that reason, you want to excise the whole thing, and that's using Sistrunk procedure. So excision of the entire tract plus the surrounding tissue, and that is considered curative. So let's take a look at other choices that do not work as well in this case. Choice A, abscess. Now there's no RAM enhancement at all, and also the subcutaneous fat looks very clean, so there's no sign of inflammation. And clinically, abscess does not fit. I would also consider metastasis less likely for the same reason, in that there's no re-enhancement or a suspicious enhancing soft tissue component. Now, it is true that some of the cystic nodal metastases can look rather benign, so you do want to be careful in real life. Now, if you suspect this is a cystic nodal metastasis, so it's coming from level 6, this is a nice diagram from radiologyassistant.nl. This is a nice website for review, so I encourage you to go there. Sometimes you can have a midline node, that's a Delphian node. So if you see a cystic nodal metastasis in this region, you want to make sure that you inspect thyroid gland. So papillary thyroid cancer can metastasize to this region. Or sometime the laryngeal carcinoma extension through the anterior commissure causing enlargement of Delphian lymph node. So that's something to consider. Another differential diagnosis for second branchial cleft cyst. Among the branchial cleft cysts, second branchial cleft cyst is by far the most common type. So that's the one that you are likely to encounter in real life. The classic location though is not here. The classic location is in this case of 12-year-old with a biopsy-proven second branchial cleft cyst. It's typically medial to the sternocleidomastoid muscle, posterior to the submandibular gland. You can see the normal gland for your reference, and they are lateral to the carotid space. And the second branchial cleft cyst, unless it's infected, should also look very benign, thin wall, homogeneous internal consistency. One thing you want to be careful about calling something second branchial cleft cyst in adult. In the same location that's classic for second branchial cleft cyst, I would make sure that this is not nodal metastasis, which is going to be more common. So this is an example of the 50-year-old with oropharyngeal carcinoma, HPV positive. Those tend to present with a cystic nodal metastasis. Now, in this case, you can see there is even a suspicious internal soft tissue component. Even though that's a classic location, I would not go with second branchial cleft cyst as my top differential diagnosis. There's a very strong uptake in the source of malignancy, so the oropharyngeal carcinoma, and the nodal metastasis itself also has a very strong uptake. So again, in a child, in a typical location, yes, that's second branchial cleft cyst. But in adult, I would consider nodal metastasis until proven otherwise. So choice C, laryngocele. This is a diagram coming from radiologykey.com. A nice diagram shows the illustration of laryngocele. So normally on the left side, you can see there's laryngeal ventricle, and that has an opening into the normal saccule. If you have an obstruction at the opening of the laryngeal ventricle, you can have it trapped over air or sometimes fluid or both, and causing dilatation of the saccule. If the dilatation of the laryngocele is confined within the thyrohyoid membrane, that's considered as internal laryngocele. If it extends beyond thyrohyoid membrane, that's the external laryngocele, or sometimes you can have both, so that will be the mixed type. When you see a laryngocele, you want to make sure you inspect very carefully at the level of laryngeal ventricle or at the level of the vocal cord. Make sure that you don't have a lesion that's causing obstruction. This is a nice example of a mixed or both internal and external laryngocele. In this case, it's filled with fluid. So nice bilobed appearance of laryngocele. Compare that to this internal laryngocele, also filled with a fluid. This one is a little bit harder to see, but you can see the asymmetry of the paraglottic fat. There is a fluid-filled internal laryngocele. That appearance is very different in location compared to our case of thyroglossal duct cyst. So all in all, this picture is most consistent with thyroglossal duct cyst. That's all for this head and neck case number 11. Thanks for your attention and good luck on your board exam.